So, our last discussion yesterday was at the process of parturition. All right. So we did discuss on the stages involved or related to parturition. Okay. Three stages of labor, and we can see that hormone basically involved in inducing the process of labor, which are oxytocin and also prostaglandin. Okay, all right. So today, and you need to know that this labor is induced by the high level of estrogen, all right, during end of pregnancy. But as a woman ataupun as the baby is delivered, so the level of progesterone as well as estrogen will drop. So that stimulating another hormone to induce lactation. Okay, so today our topic is on lactation. Okay, so lactation is secretion of milk from the mammary gland. So the secretion of milk involves two hormones, which are the prolactin and also oxytocin. So prolactin produce or stimulate milk production, whereas oxytocin stimulate ejection of milk from the mammary gland. So you can see that here, oxytocin is not only involved in inducing process of labor by stimulating contraction of uterus, oxytocin also stimulate ejection of milk from the mother's nipple. Maksudnya, ada orang yang contohlah kan, ada orang, these two eh, prolactin and oxytocin must work together. Ada orang, susu dia ada, tapi susu dia tak boleh keluar, so jadi bengkak susu. That is due to oxytocin. Right? So maybe oxytocin dia rendah, so susu tak boleh keluar, but susu is produced, but milk cannot be ejected. Okay, so tu. Alright. So as we all know, prolactin is secreted by anterior pituitary gland. Oxytocin is secreted by the posterior pituitary gland. Okay. So the effect of lactation, alright, is inhibited by progesterone and estrogen. Right, so remember, bila low level of progesterone and also low level of estrogen, right, so it will induce high level of prolactin. So it is reverse, meaning that let's say progesterone you still high, progesterone masih lagi tinggi, estrogen tinggi, alright, so it will cause prolactin to be lower. Okay, so dia adalah inhibited. So ingat ni, dua hormon ni inhibit one another. Okay, so remember after birth, remember masa hujung kehamilan kan, dan nak bersalin tu kan, level of estrogen is very, very high. So masa tu, prolactin mestilah rendah. But once the baby is delivered, level of progesterone as well as estrogen will drop. Okay, after birth, the placenta is discharged, so level of progesterone and estrogen will fall. So the decline of progesterone and estrogen will enable prolactin to promote milk production. Okay, and prolactin level will increase temporarily every time the baby suckle from the mother. So maksudnya lagi banyak baby menyusu daripada ibu dia, so lagi banyak prolactin. So lagi banyak susu akan dihasilkan. So, tapi bila baby, mak tak menyusukan anak, so otak akan stimulate, okay, tak payahlah hasilkan susu sebab baby tak minum. So that's why lama-kelamaan susu tu akan berhentilah dihasilkan. Okay, so does milk supply regulated with the demand of the baby? So nampak tak Allah control kat situ. So the more baby, feed from the mother, so the more prolactin will be produced. Okay. Okay, the more baby feed, the greater the prolactin secretion and thus more milk production. So this is again a kind of positive feedback. So kalau baby tak minum, susu tak dihasilkan. Itu je konsep dia, okay? Right, so you can see from this picture, okay? This is end of pregnancy, last week of pregnancy, right? So the high level of estrogen as well as progesterone. But as the baby is delivered, maksudnya after birth, you can see that the level of both estrogen and progesterone will drop significantly and induce the increase of prolactin secretion. Okay, all right. Okay, next one, suckling also. Okay, as the baby feed from the mother, suckling also will trigger the release of oxytocin. Right, oxytocin induce milk to flow freely, because the function of oxytocin in this case is to ensure that the milk can flow every time the baby suckle, kan? Ha, maksudnya macam itulah, dia nak pastikan susu tu mengalir dengan baik. Okay. So in it also, suckling also, right, inhibit the secretion of LH and FSH, luteinizing hormone, and also follicle stimulating hormone. So this process is called as lactational and ovulation, which suppress follicular development and also ovulation. So that's why people say that if a mother breastfeeding, ataupun Nabi pun kata susulah anak selama 2 tahun. So in other words, bila menyusukan anak, when a mother feed the baby exclusively tanpa ada campur susu-susu lain, insyaAllah dia boleh membantu untuk menjarakkan kehamilan. Kan, menjarakkan kehamilan. Kenapa? Ni, when the baby suckle, it will actually inhibit secretion of LH and FSH. So bila low FSH, low LH, no follicle stimulation, maksudnya tak ada follicle development, right? And then no ovulation. So bila no ovulation, tendency to get pregnant is very, very low. So that is according to science lah. But somehow you have to know that sekarang ni ramai je orang yang memang menyusu anak eksklusif pun dia boleh mengandung. So that is another story lah. But somehow orang kata apa? The basic science is there, right? Suckling ataupun feeding the baby exclusively can inhibit secretion of LH and FSH. Okay, but when the nursing stop, okay, maksudnya bila mak stop, berhenti menyusukan bayi, accumulation of milk in the breast will signal the brain to stop prolactin secretion. So no more milk will be produced. Okay, all right. So thus milk production will ceased. Cease here means stop ataupun berkurangan. Yeah? So, okay, any question for this one? Okay, tak ada apa eh? Faham eh? So you remember, in lactation, two hormones is very important, oxytocin and also prolactin. And these two hormones is working oppositely with estrogen and progesterone, right? And also oxytocin has another function lah. The feeding of baby has another function despite trigger the release of oxytocin. It also will inhibit secretion of LH and FSH. Okay? All right. So, sure, tak ada soalan for lactation? Okay. Tak ada. Alright, kalau tak ada, then we proceed with plant development. So, finish with human development. Okay, now we go to plant development. Okay, so again, you have to remember back what you have learned in chapter 8. Okay, development. So, ada what we call it? We have the production of seed, the fruit, okay, for flowering plants, kan? Okay, for angiosperm. Okay, so here in this chapter, subtopic, so we are going to describe the developmental stage of the seed and also the fruit. But to recap again, seed develop from the ovule. Okay, fruit is developed from the ovary. Okay. So in plant development, what we are going to learn is that we are going to see the seed development, how seed develop, and fruit development, right? So in under seed development, we will know that they involve dual jenis type of development, the endosperm development and also embryo development. So this is the context under plant development. Okay? All right, so we are going to start first with seed development. Okay, ni eh, yang ini. So under seed development ada dua what we are, yang kita akan tengok, endosperm development and also the embryo development. Okay, so the first one is endosperm development. So what is endosperm? So endosperm is basically derived from di apa nama tu? Triploid nucleus. Ya, yeah, yang kita panggil sebagai endosperm ni. Alright. So the endosperm is developed before the embryo. So endosperm akan terhasil dulu. So mana datang endosperm ni? Ingat balik. Remember, there are two sperms. Okay, one sperm fertilized with one egg and jadilah dia zygote. Right? And what happened to another sperm? Another sperm fertilized with fertilization of angiosperm. So, another sperm fertilized with diploid cell. Diploid cell, diploid yang kita panggil sebagai polar nuclei. Okay, and forming triploid cell yang kita panggil sebagai endosperm. Okay, so this is double fertilization. Two sperms, one sperm fertilized with egg forming zygote, and another sperm fertilized with the diploid cell, or we call as the polar nuclei, forming triploid ataupun triploid cells, which we call as endosperm. So this endosperm developed before the embryo itself, right? So what happened? This triploid nucleus divide repeatedly, forming a multinucleated cell, right? Ataupun kita panggil sebagai supercell of milky consistency. Alright, supercell of milky consistency. Okay, so then what happened to the endosperm? The endosperm becomes solid and it contain nutrient that is meant for the developing embryo. So endosperm ni, in other word, endosperm ni adalah tempat di mana semua nutrient yang akan digunakan oleh embryo tersimpan. Okay, so the endosperm contain starch, protein, lipid, which is stored in the endosperm of monocot or in the cotyledon of eukaryote. Okay, untuk monokot kita panggil sebagai endosperm. Look at this one. Ni. Okay, right? So this is endosperm. Yang kawasan ini, ini endosperm. Yang ini, yang dalam ni, this is the embryo. Ini adalah embryo. So ini adalah endosperm. Example here is monokot plant, the corn kernel, jagung. Okay, right. So endosperm tu contain nutrient that is used ataupun important for the developing embryo. But for eukaryote, kita tak panggil endosperm. Kita panggil sebagai cotyledon. Okay, right. Okay, this is cotyledon. Example, the green bean. Okay, kacang hijau. Green bean is a eukaryote plant. So you can see the whole thing here is known as embryo. Okay, this is the embryo. And this is the cotyledon. Okay, so this is the cotyledon. Right, so untuk dicot kita panggil sebagai cotyledon instead of endosperm. Okay, in most monocot, nutrient used by embryo during germination untuk bercambah. Alright, but for eukaryote, for most eukaryote, nutrient exported to the cotyledon before the seed completes its development. So you can see here the dicotyledon ataupun eukaryote. For eukaryote, look at here, this is the cotyledon. Nutrient will be transported into the cotyledon. Okay, so endosperm nanti akan shrink lah. You can see endosperm nanti akan shrink. Okay, and then that's why the mature seed is lacking of endosperm. Dia tak ada endosperm. Okay, but as for monocot, look at here, this is the endosperm. Okay, right. Okay, so does mature seed lack of endosperm for eukaryote plant? Dia tak ada endosperm, but dia ada cotyledon because the nutrient is transported into the cotyledon. Alright, okay. So that is the story about endosperm. Okay, any question? Okay, next we go to embryo development. Okay, tengok eh. Embryo development start daripada zygote ni. What happened to the zygote? Okay, so we are going to see what happened to the zygote here. Okay, first, look at the zygote. Okay, so firstly, first division is asymmetrical. The zygote will undergo first division, but the first division is asymmetric. Asymmetric means tak sama besar. Tak sama besar. So due to that, it will form smaller terminal cell and larger basal cell. So you can see terminal cell is smaller and the basal cell is larger. So due to the asymmetric division. Okay. Next, what happened to the basal cell? Yang besar tu. Basal cell continue dividing and forming a row of cells known as suspensor. Okay. So you can see. Minimai. Okay. So next is, you can see this suspensor, basal cell undergo repeated cell division and known as suspensor. Nampak tak ni? So this is suspensor. Okay. And then what happened to the suspensor? Right? The suspensor transfer nutrient from the endosperm to the embryo. Okay, so itu tugas suspensor, transfer nutrient from endosperm to the embryo. And what happened to the terminal cell? Ni yang terminal cell yang ni pula. Okay, suspensor dah settle. So this is suspensor. Okay, so what happened next? To the terminal cell divide repeatedly and forming a globular or spherical pro-embryo that is attached to suspensor. So you can see. The terminal cell divide jadi dua. Okay, cell embryo now jadi four. And then divide and jadi this one. Okay, this one. Spherical or globular pro-embryo that is attached to the suspensor. Okay, and then next what happened to the pro-embryo? The early formation of cotyledon in dicot give the embryo a heart shape appearance. Okay, embryo then elongates and changes into torpedo shape embryo. So you can see what happened to the globular stages. Dia akan jadi heart shape pro embryo. Okay, and after that dia akan elongate and jadilah torpedo shape. Here, torpedo shape. Embryo. So technically cotyledon tu adalah embryo. Okay. Boleh eh? So ikut sequence process je sahaja. Boleh? Okay. Boleh eh? Alright. So this one. So inilah dia kejadian dia. You can see this is the cotyledon. Nampak tak? This is a torpedo shaped cotyledon. Okay. Attached to the suspensor. So this is the suspensor and this is the endosperm. Okay, so maksudnya kalau untuk eudicot, nutrient daripada endosperm dia akan transfer pergi ke cotyledon. Actually the cotyledon is the embryo itself lah. Macam tu. Okay, but for monocot, the nutrient is in the endosperm itself. Okay. Alright. Okay, next. Structure of a mature seed. Okay, seed dehydrate at the late of maturation. Okay, until its water content is only about 5 to 15% of its weight. And during this time, embryo is surrounded by food supply, the cotyledon, endosperm or both. Okay, so maksudnya seed bila dia nak mature, dia akan kehilangan air. Alright, so dia punya berat dah paling ringan lah kiranya macam tu. Okay, and at this point of time, the embryo become dormant. So dormant means very minimal metabolic activities. Dalam bahasa lain yang macam dia ajar masa chapter hormon, stay still, do nothing. Something like that. Macam duduk, dia tunggu pada masa yang optimum. Okay. Alright. So dormancy in seed is a condition whereby the growth and metabolism will be ceased ataupun stop. So this is what mean by dormancy. Okay. Next. Embryo differentiate into three main parts. Embryo will differentiate into three main parts. The first one is radical, embryonic root. This one, radical, yang akan jadi akar. Next one is plumule. The plumule consists of epicotyl, young leaves, shoot, and also apical meristem. Okay, yang ni plumule. So plumule tu nanti akan membentuk sama ada epicotyl, young leaves, shoot. Okay, and next one is cotyledon, which will become the seed leaves. Okay, either one or two. Kalau two, eudicot. Kalau one, monocot. Okay, and this is the remain of the endosperm lah. Ini endosperm yang remain tu. Ini adalah cotyledon kita tu. Okay, testa. Testa tu ialah dia punya coating yang luar, kulit luar dia. Macam kalau kacang hijau, bila kacang hijau tu germinate, kan dia pecahkan, dia punya warna hijau tu terpecah kan. Itu testa. Okay. Alright. Okay, so look at the monocot seed embryo here. So for monocot seed embryo, like maize, for example. So the structure the scutellum. Okay, untuk monocot seed embryo, structure dia ialah scutellum, which is the specialized cotyledon. Ni. Dia adalah cotyledon lah, tapi kita panggil untuk monocot, kita panggil dia scutellum. This one, scutellum. Next one is coleoptile. Coleoptile covers the young shoot. This one. Okay. And next one is coleorhiza. Cover the young root. Okay, so this is the structure of a monocot seed embryo. Scutellum, coleoptile, coleorhiza. Okay, untuk embryo. Okay, and next one is, sorry, for eudicot seed embryo, you can see the structure here of the cotyledon. Satu cotyledon, dua cotyledon, two cotyledons. Okay, and the plumule. Plumule nanti akan jadi shoot, young leaves. Okay. Alright. And radical, which will become the young root. Later on, the cotyledon will become the leaves. And this is a testa. Okay. Alright. So, tu je lah. Nak tahu structure je. Maksudnya bila tengok gambar ataupun you kena tahu component of monocot embryo, apa component dia. And what about eudicot embryo. Okay. Okay. Dah eh. Next, we go to the process of seed germination. Proses percambahan. Remember, when a mature seed, is reaching to a mature stage, it will lose weight until 5 to 15%. So now, kita nak pergi kepada proses germination. How it is germinate. Okay, dormancy increases the chances that germination will occur at a time and place that is most advantageous to the seedling. So breaking dormancy and stimulation of germination requires certain environmental condition like suitable enough water, suitable temperature, light and any other growth promoters. Okay, right. And duration of dormancy varies in species, plant, certain species of plant and also jenis-jenis dia lah. Okay, berbeza, tak sama eh. Alright, so this is an example of biochemical mechanism for seed germination in cereal grain. Okay, cereal grain is an example of apa nama? Monocot. Okay, you can see the endosperm is very big kat situ. Right, so this is the embryo. Ni embryo dia. Okay. You can see the plumule, the radical, right? And then, apa lagi tadi? Okay. Okay, jom tengok mechanism dia. Okay, so the mechanism start by process of inhibition. Okay, kita tahu kan, ingat tak masa kita belajar chapter 4, gibberellin. Gibberellin stimulate seed germination. So here, kita nak belajar how gibberellin stimulate seed germination tu. Okay. Alright, so it starts with the process of imbibition. So imbibition is the uptake of water due to low water potential of the dry seed. Remember, dry seed ialah matured seed. Okay, so what happened? The dry seed will then ambil air. Contoh macam kita ambil kacang hijau, kita rendamkan dalam air kan, kita letak atas tisu lembap. So imbibition will take place. So the dry seed will take up water by osmosis. So this process we call as imbibition. So what happened to the seed? The seed will expand and rupture its seed coat. So pecahlah kacang hijau tu punya, kulit luar tu akan pecah. Ingat tak? Kan? Okay. And then cellular respiration will start. Okay. The embryo will release gibberellin into endosperm. Tengok gambar ni. First process is imbibition, uptake of water and cause the cell to, the seed to swell and rupturing the seed coat. Okay. At the same time, you can see later, gibberellin will be released and acting on, okay, gibberellin will be released to the endosperm. Ni. Embryo release gibberellin into the endosperm. And what happened to the gibberellin? Gibberellin act on aleuron layer. Maksudnya target area dia is aleuron layer. Tengok sini. Gibberellin act on aleuron layer. This is aleuron layer. Okay, alright. So what happened? So gibberellin act on aleuron layer, stimulating aleuron layer to synthesize digestive enzyme. Okay, enzyme hydrolyze stored food in the endosperm into a soluble molecule or monomer. So you can see here, aleuron layer synthesize digestive enzyme. Contoh, amylase. Amylase will hydrolyze starch that is stored in the endosperm into simple sugar. And the sugar will be transported into cotyledon for growth and germination. Okay, selain daripada amylase, right? So it also synthesize or stimulate the synthesis of protease. Protease will digest protein into peptide or amino acid. And lipase will digest lipid into fatty acid and glycerol. All right, so that's how germination will takes place. So what happened to the nutrient just now? Has it is produced ataupun hydrolyzed from a complex molecule into simpler one, the nutrient is mobilized by the enzyme, will be absorbed by the scutellum. Remember, scutellum ialah specialized cotyledon of monocot. Okay, next, what will happen? The nutrient will be then transferred to the embryo, used by the embryo for energy, growth, synthesis of polymer, and then translocated into plumule and radical for germination. So plumule nanti jadi shoot, radical nanti jadi root. Allah. Okay, faham eh? Okay, all right. Okay, next, we are going to see the type of seedlings, jenis-jenis percambahan. Germinating seed continue to undergo metabolic changes, culminating into a seedling. There are two types of seedling growth, epigeal germination, and the other one is hypogeal germination. Epigeal germination. And number two is hypogeal germination. Tak ada. Okay, hypogeal germination. Okay, so let's start with the first type of germination, epigeal germination. Example of epigeal germination usually found in many eudicots like sunflower, long beans, garden beans. Okay, so most of the eudicot lah, most eudicot akan undergo epigeal germination. So during epigeal germination, okay, hypocotyl will elongate. Hypocotyl will elongate. So what is hypocotyl? Hypocotyl is area below cotyledon. Kawasan di bawah cotyledon. Okay, this one eh. Sekejap. Tengok gambar ni dulu. Okay. This is okay, this is the cotyledon. Okay, you can see that area below the cotyledon. You bayangkan kita ambil cotyledon tu, kita tegakkan dia macam ni. So bawah cotyledon. So this one ialah area below the cotyledon. We call as hypocotyl. Okay, alright. So you can see hypocotyl elongate. Okay, when hypocotyl elongate, it will push epicotyl and cotyledon above the soil surface. Okay, look at here. Nampak? When hypocotyl elongate, dia memanjang, memanjang, memanjang. Dia tolak, dia bawa sekali cotyledon and hypocotyl above the surface. Okay, you bayangkan eh? Dia panjang, 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 panjang. So, cotyledon akan terbawa naik ke tanah. Okay, so what happened? Cotyledon will become photosynthetic since it is emerged above the soil. And what happened to the seed coat? Seed coat also emerged from the soil. Okay, nampak ni gambar? Seed coat emerge. Ni, seed coat emerge from the soil. And then cotyledon will become photosynthetic. Remember, cotyledon akan jadi apa nanti? Cotyledon akan jadi daun. Okay. Epicotyl akan jadi apa? Dia macam akan jadi pucuk. Okay? Right. Sekejap lagi ada video eh, mana tunjuk. Okay. And next one is hypogeal. Okay, keyword. Keyword apa? Untuk epigeal germination, which one will elongate? You ingat ni, hypocotyl. Hypocotyl will elongate. Okay, so in hypogeal germination, so dia akan terbalik. In hypogeal germination, siapa yang akan memanjang? Epicotyl. Okay, alright, dia akan terbalik. Okay, in hypogeal germination, mostly happen to kind of germination that happen to wheat, rice, maize, grass and many monocots. So here in hypogeal germination, epicotyl will elongate. Epicotyl is area above cotyledon. Bahagian atas cotyledon. So macam mana rupa dia? Tengok ni. Okay, so this is cotyledon. Right? Bahagian atas cotyledon. Right? So epicotyl will elongate. Epicotyl dia yang memanjang. So what happened to your cotyledon? Cotyledon emerge above the soil ke remain underground? Underground. Okay. So when epicotyl elongate, it pushes coleoptile and plumule or shoot tips above the soil surface. Okay. The shoot tip breaks through the coleoptile tips upon emergence. Cotyledon remain underground, does not become photosynthetic. So what happened to the seed coat? Seed coat also remain inside the soil. Okay, so that is the difference between hypogeal germination and epigeal germination. So keyword dia awak terbalikkan saja. So kalau hypogeal germination, epicotyl elongate. In epigeal germination, hypocotyl elongate. But you have to understand, epicotyl tu area above ke below. Itu kena hafal lah. Okay? Alright. So look at here. Again. Okay. This is monocotyledon. Tengok ni, epicotyl elongates. It pushes coleoptile above the soil surface. So cotyledon remain underground. So cotyledon will not become photosynthetic. Okay, but as for a dicotyledon, you can see in dicotyledon, hypocotyl elongate. So it will push the cotyledon above the soil surface and cotyledon become photosynthetic. The seed coat also emerge. Okay. Okay, so tengok ni eh. Okay. See, this one is the epigeal germination. Look at hypocotyl elongates. It pushes the cotyledon upwards to the surface of soil. Eh? Okay, cotyledon emerge from the soil surface, right, and become photosynthetic. Okay, for hypogeal, you can see that. Look at the cotyledon here. Only epicotyl elongates. So cotyledon remain underground. Okay, alamak, iklan pula. Okay. Right, it pushes the plumo lah to the surface. Okay, something macam tu lah. Nah, okay, so take 5 minutes break. Prepare with your notes for chapter 10. Kita jumpa lagi 5 minit. Okay? Okay, so our new chapter is immunology. Okay? So, this is something new. And of course, the basic of this chapter, I guess you also pun dah belajar masa sekolah related to antibody, some of the cell important in the immune system. Okay? So, at least you dah ada basic sikit lah. Alright, so first thing first that you need to know on immunology, so how our body immune system work is by looking at the overview of human immunological defenses, okay? Right, so this is our defense. So we are actually having 3 lines of defense. Allah bagi kat kita, ada 3 jenis peringkat defense badan kita, okay? So you can see here, the first one, as pathogen invade the tissue, right? So badan kita bertindak secara serentak for orang kata apa, reacting or responding with this pathogen. First, rapid response. Second one is a little bit delay of response. Okay? So the rapid response is known as non-specific immune responses, or we call as innate immune response. So ini akan bertindak sebagai barisan hadapan dulu, right? The rapid or we call as non-specific. So this non-specific immune response divided into 2, the first line defense and the second line defense. The first line defense are our physical barriers like our skin, the mucus lining of respiratory tract kita, the mucus lining of the digestive system and urinary system kita. So this acting as our first line defense. So mucus yang kita ada, goblet cell secret mucus tu. So that mucus help to trap debris ataupun help to trap pathogen. So then kita akan batuk. Bila kita batuk, kita keluarlah kahak ke whatever kan. So that is our first line of defense. Okay? So at the same time, our body also work with the second line of defense. So the second line of defense under non-specific immune response is the production of antimicrobial protein. Badan kita akan menghasilkan protein yang bertindak balas sebagai antimicrobial lah, okay, antibakteria ke apa ke. Yang pertama. Yang kedua, our second line of defense have cells. They are the natural killer cell and also phagocytes. Ada juga sel-sel yang bertindak dalam badan kita, phagocytes pergi engulf, okay, makan pathogen-pathogen dan sebagainya tu. So that is second line of defense. And also the including inflammation. Okay, proses di mana berlakunya keradangan. Contoh, bila kita luka, perasan tak? Bila kita luka, tempat kita luka tu akan macam merah ke, bengkak ke. So, that is inflammation. So, that inflammation actually indicates your body is actually fighting. Right? By means of phagocytosis occur. Right? Maksudnya bila kita berlaku luka-luka kat situ, sebenarnya kat situ phagocyte ada datang, engulf dan menyebabkan berlakunya sedikit keradangan. Okay, so that is the second line of defense. So, this inflammation, let's say bila berlaku keradangan, tak mau bagi keradangan tu berterusan, So badan kita pun sebenarnya is preparing for the specific immune response, which is the third line of defense. Cuma this third line of defense requires time sikit lah. Orang yang akan datang dulu memang first line lah. First line, second line. So yang ini macam tentera elit lah. Katakan tentera elit yang di barisan yang paling belakang sekali akan jaga tu. Okay. Right. So this is what we call as specific or adaptive immune response. So this one involve the cell mediated immunity and humoral immunity. Alright, so apa itu cell mediated, apa itu humoral immunity, we are going to discuss later. So this is the overall view of our immune system. So let's say, kita akan kata macam madam, kita dah ada first line, second line semua kan, kenapa kita sakit juga? So kena fahamlah, tentera barisan hadapan tu biasanya tentera-tentera biasa je. Kan, of course lah kadang-kadang gagal. So kita akan menggunakan tentera barisan kedua. Macam itulah. So kadang-kadang gagal juga dan masuk ke tentera barisan ketiga. Pun sama walaupun tentera elit, kadang-kadang tentera-tentera ni lambat kenal pasti ke ataupun tentera tu terjangkiti ke something like that. So dia akan menyebabkan sistem tu gagal berfungsi dengan baik. Okay, alright. So I got this from Telegram kesihatan something macam tu kan, okay. And I found that this is quite useful for you to understand how our body immune system work, right? And this is mostly under our third line of defense, the adaptive ataupun kita panggil sebagai specific immune response. So for example, we are dealing with specific things to fight with. For example, the virus of COVID-19, right? So tengok sini. So why vaccination? Actually, we are talking about vaccination. Nanti kita akan belajar tajuk vaccination. So why vaccination is very important, okay? So let's say vaccination is this COVID-19 ialah intruders lah, intruders. Okay, so you need to know our body immune system kita, the third line of defense consists of some cells like T helper cell, okay? The macrophage, okay? And also macrophage is in the second line of defense tadi tu, and also killer cell, right? So and also there are some of them yang ada tugas yang lain. For example, to mengenal pasti ataupun untuk mengenal pasti kalau ada penceroboh. So itu ada sel yang bertugas untuk benda tu, okay? And ada sel yang memang tugas dia serang bunuh. So this is our body defense, okay? So this macrophage dengan killer cell memang tugas dia membunuh lah. Okay, so tengok sini contoh. The helper cell, the helper T cell, tugas helper T cell tu is actually untuk mengenal pasti penceroboh. Sometimes the helper T cell lambat mengenal pasti penceroboh yang datang. Padahal tugas dia memang untuk check, tapi dia lambat dapat maklumat tersebut, kan? So what happen? Virus tu sebenarnya dah terinfect, dah go into our body, multiplying in our body and actually affecting our immune system. Okay, for example tengok ni, tentera yang kuat semua dah jadi macam zombie dah sebab dah terinfect, something like that. Okay, kita nak bayangkan macam tu. So apabila immune system kita lambat mengenal pasti penceroboh lebih awal, so dia akan membiak dan menyebabkan barisan pertahanan gagal berfungsi dengan baik. So end up dia akan menyebabkan our organ rosak ataupun boleh menyebabkan kematian. But if let's say we took vaccination, ni sebenarnya saya nak cerita masa topik vaccination, tapi I just use it as introduction untuk bagi you rasa best sebenarnya belajar immune system ni, kan. So vaccine, right, is actually a virus in the form that is a death ataupun non-infected yang telah dilemahkan. Okay, so kita ambil certain portion ataupun antigen of the virus yang takkan boleh affecting our body, masukkan dalam badan kita. So bila masuk dalam badan kita, so our body recognize as something that is foreign. Badan kita rasa macam, badan kita akan kata pasti, ni bukan geng-geng kita ni orang luar ni. Something like that macam tu, okay. So apabila disuntik dalam badan, ia tidak memudaratkan badan, tetapi the T helper cell will recognize it. the helper dah nampak dah, oh okay ni orang asing ni, so kita kena ambil maklumat dia, rupa dia macam mana, bentuk dia macam mana, dia pakai topi ke apa ke, semua dia dah ambil maklumat. So penceroboh dia kenal pasti and recorded. So itu tugas vaccination. Okay, to get initial recollection. Okay, and then preparation. Okay, so next one is, since dah dikenal pasti, so our body is actually preparing for the, kata apa, real one. Let's say coming later on. Okay, so apa yang terjadi, kalau the real COVID-19 virus enter the body, so actually our body defense is ready. Dah tahu dah, kalau yang datang besok, rupa dia macam gini, macam ni, macam ni, dah tahu dah nak serang macam mana, macam tu. Okay, so that is the importance of what we call it, having vaccination, alright, and knowing on how the body system work. Okay, alright, so ini yang kita akan belajar, okay. Okay, so, alright, there are two types of immune system. Okay, the specific, non-specific. Okay, ingat tadi yang ni. Okay, non-specific. So the non-specific we call as innate immunity. So kita akan start first with the innate immunity. Okay, right. Innate immunity is the non-specific immunity. It usually present before any exposure to pathogen. So this kind of immunity memang dah ada. Contoh kulit, dah ada dah. Mucus memang dah sedia ada dah. Kan? So tu. It present before any exposure to pathogen and it is effective from the time of birth. So it is largely non-specific. Non-specific means dia tak terhad kepada mana-mana specific apa nama, pathogen pun. Okay? So semua boleh. Virus ke, bacteria ke, parasite ke, any other microbe ke, dia non-specific. So, it responds to a broad range of microbes. It consists of external physical barrier like the skin, mucous membrane and also mucous secretion, and the internal cellular and chemical defenses. Internal cellular cells, okay, sel-sel yang ada dalam badan kita, and also chemical defenses like antimicrobial protein dan sebagainya. Okay. So, it prevents most pathogen from entering the body. Okay. Those that penetrate external defense are rapidly destroyed by the internal defense. So let's say kulit, dia berjaya tembus kulit kita. Contoh bila kita luka kena paku. So microbe senang untuk masuk dalam kita punya open wound. So then our internal defense will take place. Okay. Alright. So this is the innate immunity tadi, non-specific. Okay. Pathogen can be anything. Right, as long as it can cause disease. Okay, so bacteria ke, fungi ke, virus ke, parasites ke, kan? Okay, so this innate immunity recognize traits that is shared by broad ranges of pathogen. Okay, and it is a kind of rapid response, including the physical barrier, skin, mucus, and internal defense like phagocytic cell, natural killer cell, antimicrobial proteins and also inflammatory response. So this is our under non-specific immune system. Kalau this non-specific immune system kita tertembus juga, gagal untuk mempertahankan juga, then we have the adaptive immune response, which we call as the specific immune response. Specific immune response. So you can see the specific immune response recognize specific or a particular pathogen using a vast array of receptors. So dia tahu kalau specific, kalau bacteria macam ni lawannya. Kalau virus macam ni lawannya. Ni macam ni lawannya, dia specific. Okay. And usually it is slower response because it takes time to respond. Okay, it divided into two. Humoral immune response, which produce antibody. Okay. And cell-mediated immune response that produce cytotoxic cells that defend against the infection. Okay, boleh faham ke? Innate immunity?
Boleh.
Okay, so this is just roughly sahaja. We are not going into the detail for innate immunity. Tapi kita akan fokus lebih kepada adaptive immunity. So remember, adaptive immunity divided into humoral response, cell-mediated immune response. Chemo response produce antibody, okay, specific antibody, and cell-mediated immune response produce cytotoxic cells. Okay, adaptive immunity. Okay, it is known as the specific immunity. It developed only after exposure to the microbe, abnormal body cells, or any other foreign substances. Benda-benda asing. Right? So, dia hanya akan bertindak balas selepas berlakunya exposure kepada that particular microbes ataupun pathogen. And it is highly specific. Maksudnya, kalau microbe yang datang, cara nak lawan, kena lawan specific kepada microbe. Kalau fungi ke, specific. So, dia specific. Tindak balas dia adalah specific. So, the recognition achieved by the white blood cell. In other words, yang mengenal pasti cara macam mana nak lawan ke apa ke, the white blood cell, lymphocytes. Okay. There are two types of adaptive immunity. Humoral immune response and cell-mediated immune response. Okay, so before we go to the process on ataupun mechanism on how the immune response immune system work, so we have to know what is antigen and what is antibody. Okay, apa itu antigen? Antigen is any foreign molecule. Antigen. Any foreign molecule that is recognized and elicits a response by lymphocyte. Elicits mean menyebabkan berlakunya tindak balas daripada lymphocyte. So itu maksudnya elicits. Okay, so maksudnya antigen ialah apa sahaja benda asing yang badan kita kenal sebagai benda asing dan menyebabkan badan kita bertindak balas kepadanya. Badan kita bertindak balas kepadanya tu siapa yang bertindak balas? Lymphocyte. Akan bertindak balas kepadanya. So that is antigen. Okay. A lymphocyte actually recognize and bind to the portion of an antigen. Lymphocyte will bind and recognize to a small portion of antigen. We call as epitope or antigenic determinant. Okay. Epitope tu apa? Okay. Ingat tadi antigen is any foreign molecule that is recognized by our body as foreign, and our body, which is the lymphocyte, will respond toward it. And how lymphocyte kenal? Lymphocyte kenal by binding to the small portion of antigen, which we call as epitope. Contoh. Tengok pen ni. Contohlah pen ni ialah foreign antigen, foreign molecule kita panggil sebagai antigen. So, lymphocyte nak kenal, tak perlu nak kena ada lengkap ni, semua lengkap bentuk pen ni, baru dia kenal, oh ini adalah pen. Tak. Dia akan bind to small portion of the antigen. Dia jumpa tutup ni je. Ataupun dia jumpa lid hujung ni je. Right? So, any small portion of the antigen, kita panggil epitope. So, it will bind only to the small portion of the antigen. It will then respond toward it. Macam tu. Faham eh? Contohlah sama macam any virus ke bacteria ke kan? So our body will recognize the small portion of it. Contoh macam dia pakai satu baju, contohlah kita bayangkan foreign molecule tu lengkap. Medium ni adalah foreign molecule. So you all bukan kena tunggu the whole thing ni baru you tahu oh ini lah medium. Tak. Mungkin you hanya tengok certain portion saja. Okay, tudung dia warna ni kan, ni mesti medium. Macam tu. Right? So just tengok any small portion of it, we call as epitope. Okay? Right. A single antigen usually has several different epitopes. Okay? For example, look at this one. This is antigen. And this antigen has different epitopes. Nampak ni? Satu bentuk macam ni. Okay? Satu bentuk macam gini. Satu bentuk macam gini. Right. So what happened? These different epitope will be recognized and responded by the lymphocyte differently and thus produce different antibody. For example, antibody A specifically untuk this kind of epitope. Okay. Antibody B ni specific untuk this epitope. Antibody C ni specific untuk this epitope. So that's why kita panggil sebagai specific immune response. Okay. Ikut apa yang dia jumpa dan apa yang dia kenal pasti. Right? Look at this antibody. Nampak tak? Antibody ni binding site dia match dengan this epitope. Antibody ni, dia punya binding site dia match with this epitope. Okay? Macam tu. Alright. Antigen and antibody. Okay, so this is tadi antigen. Right, look at the epitope. How many epitope dia ada? Satu, dua, tiga jenis epitopes. Alright. And now let's look at the structure of antibody. Okay, this is the structure of antibody. Antibody structure. Okay, so let's see antibody structure. Typical antibody is made up of four polypeptide chains. Two identical heavy chain and two identical light chain. Okay, two identical heavy chain yang mana satu? Yang ni. This one. This is heavy chain. Two identical heavy chain and two identical light chain. Okay? Right. So, to. Next, the chain. The heavy chain are joined by disulfide bond and forming a Y-shaped molecule. So, that's why gambar ni pun kita tengok seolah-olah antibody tu bentuk Y. Sebab ni lah. Right? Okay. So, the light chain and the heavy chain are joined together by disulfide bridges. Disulfide bond. This is disulfide bond. Okay. This one. So, and make it a Y-shaped structure. Okay, next. Each chain has constant region and variable region. Okay. And it is joined together by junctional region. Okay, this one. This is the constant region, ni. Constant region, and this is variable region. Okay, so the constant region and variable region is joined together by yang warna biru ni, junctional region. Okay, so variable region tu adalah berlainan lah. Maksudnya kalau antibody A, dia punya region ni berbeza. Antibody yang lain, bentuk dia ni lain lagi. So this is, that's why kita panggil sebagai variable region. Okay, macam ni. Nampak tak? This is variable region. Lain. Ni variable region dia lain. Tapi dia punya constant region dia semua sama. Alright, so that is antibody. Okay. Okay, so the antibody is actually constitute a group of globular serum protein known as immunoglobulins. Immunoglobulins ataupun immunoglobulins, IGs. Bukan Instagram eh. Okay, IG. So ingat kena buat huruf besar, IG. Okay, so this is immunoglobulin ataupun immunoglobulins. And there are five major classes of antibody. IgM, IgG, IgA, IgE, IgD. Kena hafal, kena hafal. And each of these IGs has different function. Ada fungsi yang berbeza. Okay, right. Ada yang sangat banyak dalam susu, ada yang sangat banyak dalam apa nama ni, semasa macam-macam lah, nanti kita tengok. Okay. Alright, so this is the five major classes of antibody. Okay, and now let's see how antibody mediated disposal of antigen. Macam mana antibody bunuh antigen. Okay, so antibody bind to the antigen and activate the antigen by various methods. The first one is viral neutralization. You ada gambar dia dalam textbook, okay? So viral neutralization is blocking the binding to host. So antibody kita tolong elakkan virus tu daripada bind ataupun reach to the host cell and thus increase the process of phagocytosis. So nampak tak ni? Let's say this is bacteria, this is virus. So antibody neutralize it. Nampak macam kepung dia lah. So bila kepung dia, dia tak boleh pergi nak menginfect the body cells. Okay, so once it is neutralized, so you can see it will enhance the process of phagocytosis. Macrophage akan datang dan makan dia. Bunuhlah kiranya. Okay, second one is agglutination. Penggumpalan. Penggumpalan. Okay, agglutination of antigen-bearing particle such as microbe. So, look at here. This is bacteria. Nampak tak? Ini adalah satu jenis antibody. Dan satu jenis antibody ni nampak dia boleh bind kepada 5 bakteria sekaligus. Right? Dan gumpalkan dia. Something like that. So, again, it will enhance the process of phagocytosis. The third one is precipitation. Okay? Of soluble antigen. So, daripada dia soluble, dia akan jadi tak soluble. Okay? So, jadi precipitate. Okay? For example, you can see this is the soluble antigen. So, once it bind with the antibody, dia akan jadi precipitate and enhance phagocytosis. And last one is activation of complement system. Okay. So, this is a foreign cell. Contoh, foreign cell. And dekat surface ni nanti akan ada complement protein. And complement protein ni akan menghasilkan pore. So, pore ni akan menyebabkan air masuk dalam sel ni. And lama-lama sel ni akan pecah. So, foreign cell tu akan pecah. So, cell lysis will occur. Okay? Alright. Okay, neutralization. See, it cannot infect the body host. Agglutination. Okay, so that is some example of how antibody fight with the antigen. Any question? Tak ada? Alright. So you have this actually notes in the textbook, right? What is meant by viral neutralization? Okay. And you can see antibody bind to certain protein on the surface of the virus and blocking it from infecting the host. Viral neutralization. Second one is opsonization. Okay. So the bound antibodies will enhance macrophage attachment and increase phagocytosis. Okay. Agglutination, clumping atau bergumpal. So it will form aggregates that can readily phagocytosize by macrophage. Okay. Precipitation, yang macam tadi tu. Cross-link of soluble antigen. Alright. And disposed by pathogen. Phagocytes. Alright. Okay, so this is the formation of complement system. Ini yang tadi Mili cakap tu yang dia buat lubang tu. Okay, bayangkan this is the antigen membrane. Okay, so you can see antibody bind. Alright, the binding of antibody will activate the complement system. So, complement system attack by forming pores on the antigen's plasma membrane and induce the process of lysis. So, you can see water will flow. Air akan masuk dalam sel ni. Sel ni akan kembang dan pecah. So, foreign antigen tu akan matilah. Macam tu. Okay. Boleh ke?
Boleh.
Okay. So next one, discuss the structure and function of cells in adaptive immune response. So what are the cells involved in the specific immune response? So remember adaptive tadi, kita cakap pasal specific immune response. Okay, they are divided into two, humoral and also cell mediated immune response. Okay, so ada dua lah. So now let's see what are the cells involved in the adaptive immune response. Okay, they are two key cells, the lymphocyte and also antigen presenting cell known as APC. Okay, so kadang-kadang dia tak guna perkataan antigen presenting cell, dia guna APC saja. So you kena fahamlah APC tu maksudnya antigen presenting cell. Lymphocytes ada dua. B lymphocyte and C lymphocyte ataupun kita panggil sebagai B cell and T cell. Eh, apa ni? Okay. B cell and T cell. Okay? Alright. So where are these cell came from? So the cell actually came from the bone marrow stem cell. Okay? So from bone marrow, you can see bone marrow kita produce different kind of cells, natural killer cell, monocyte. Okay? Monocyte ni nanti will develop and differentiate into macrophage. Some of them akan jadi dendritic cell. Okay? So dendritic cell ni adalah sejenis ABC. Okay, next one. Some of the cell from the bone marrow, right, migrate into the thymus gland and mature in the thymus gland. So that is the T cells ataupun T lymphocytes. Okay, so T lymphocyte pula later on once it is mature, it will be migrate into lymph nodes. And some of them, some of the T cells are memory T cell, T cytotoxic cell and also T helper cell. Okay, and some of the cell will keep matured in the bone marrow and this is known as the B cell. So B cell, some of them will differentiate into plasma cell and some will differentiate into memory B cells. Okay, so these T cells, yeah, T cells involved in cell mediated immune response and the B cells involved in antibody mediated immune response. Alright, so itu cerita dia lah, lebih kurang. And you can see that, nampak tak anak panah ni, dendritic, tiba-tiba anak panah kepada T cell. Dia nak bagi tahu yang dendritic is antigen presenting cell. Antigen presenting cell maksudnya apa? Cell yang present antigen. Ataupun bahasa Melayunya lah, cell yang menunjukkan kehadiran antigen. Kepada siapa? Kepada T cell. Okay, so tu nanti kita belajar detail tu. Okay, there are two main type of lymphocytes, T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes, known as T and B cells. Okay, so this is the structure of the B cell. So ini Madam nak minta you all tolong tengok, fahamkan betul-betul. Okay, this is B cell. Nampak eh? This is B cell receptor. Bentuk dia macam bentuk antibody. Okay, kenapa? Sebab dia terlibat dalam penghasilan antibody nanti. Tu nanti kita belajar. Okay, so this is the kata apa, overview of B cell. Okay, look at the receptor sama. Made of two heavy chain, two light chain. Okay, and then dia ada antigen binding site here of the variable region kat sini. Bentuk dia macam bentuk antibody. So ingat eh, sebab B cell nanti terlibat dalam penghasilan antibody. Okay. Satu. Nombor dua. Now look at the shape of T cell. Lain kan? So itu cara nak kenal B cell dengan T cell. B cell, the ni, the B cell antigen receptor, bentuk dia macam bentuk antibody. Okay. But for T cells, you can see dia hanya bentuk two chain sahaja. Ni sahaja. Dua chain ni sahaja. Okay, and this is the antigen binding site. So ini bentuk T cell. Okay. Let's see the shape of T cell. Okay. T cell or T lymphocytes involved in cell mediated immunity. It is the body cellular soldiers. Dia adalah ni lah. Tentera lah. Dia akan bunuh, dia akan halang dan sebagainya. And it will travel to the site of infection and destroy the foreign cells ataupun the mutated cells. So itu tugas T sebagai tentera. Bila kata tentera, kat mana tempat yang berlaku infection, dia akan pergi kat sana. Okay, alright. So T cell receptor consists of two different polypeptide chain. Two different polypeptide chain, right? Yang ini. Ni. Two different polypeptide chain. Nampak tak ni? Okay, itu saja. Dia bukan made of four polypeptide chain. it made of two polypeptide chain. Okay, the T cell bind to the small fragment of antigen that are bound to a normal cell surface protein called as MHC molecule. Okay, apa tu MHC molecule? Okay, nanti belajar sekarang. Tak apa, biar dulu MHC tu. Okay, right. T cells identified by the T cells antigen receptor. Okay, ingat tadi T cell ada tiga jenis. T helper, T helper cell, T cytotoxic cell, cytotoxic cell, and lagi satu T memory, T memory cell ni. Okay, yang nombor tiga. So macam mana nak kenal T helper, T memory and also T cytotoxic? It is identified by the T cells receptor. Maksudnya yang ini. Ini. Receptor dia berbeza. Okay? Right. Okay. Now let's see the difference between T cytotoxic and T helper cell. Okay. Look at here. T cytotoxic, also known as TC cell. Bukan teluk cempedak. Okay. TC cell. Okay. TC cell has accessory protein. Ada protein tambahan namanya CD8 protein. While T helper ataupun namanya TH cell has CD4 protein. Okay. Nampak tak ni? Tengok ni. Ni adalah T helper. This is CD4. The accessory protein. And this is a T cytotoxic cell. And ini accessory protein dia. CD8. Okay, alright. So what is the function of TC cell? TC cell recognize and destroy cell with foreign antigen, including virus, infected cell, cell yang terjangkiti, kan? Mana-mana cell yang terjangkiti dia akan bunuh, cancer cell, and foreign tissue graft. Foreign tissue graft maksudnya tissue yang kita tampal ataupun implant tissue. Itu kita panggil sebagai foreign tissue graft. So ini tugas T cytotoxic cell. As for T helper, nama pun helper. Okay. Tengok dalam gambar yang kita tengok mula-mula tadi. Apa tugas helper? Helper tugasnya untuk recognize, untuk activate. Itu tugas helper. Okay. Right. T helper cell secrete cytokine to activate B cell, T cells and macrophage. Nama dia helper. So tugas dia lah untuk secrete cytokine. Contoh macam dia panggil, dia keluarkan cytokine. Cytokine ialah chemical messenger. So bila chemical messenger tu dia keluarkan, dia akan panggil ataupun activate B cell, T cell, macrophage to the site of infection. Okay, itu tugas T helper. So lelah T helper macam dia keluarkan signal, ting 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 ting. Wah, kat sini ada infection ni. So nanti B cell datang, macrophage datang, macam tu. Okay, itu tugas T helper cell. Alright, B cells are known as B lymphocyte. So B cell involved in antibody mediated immunity. In other words, it involved in the production of antibody. Okay, so B lymphocyte matures into plasma cell. Okay, B lymphocyte matures into plasma cell and produce specific antibody. So ingat ni, B cell, okay, dia akan differentiate into plasma cell and plasma cell secrete antibody. Okay, alright. So this antibody will bind to specific antigen. Bila dah ada antibody, antibody akan bind to specific antigen yang macam kita tengok tadi. So antibody tu boleh menjalankan neutralization ke, opsonization ke, agglutination ke, and marking for destruction. Alright, so thus it is also involved in chemical defense. Okay, B cell are often called as membrane antibodies or membrane immunoglobulin. Okay, so the difference between B cell and T cell, kenapa namanya B, kenapa namanya T? Okay, B cell complete maturation in the bone marrow. So B came from bone, whereby T cells, they migrate, they keluar daripada bone marrow and it mature in the thymus gland. So that's why nama dia jadi T for thymus. Ini adalah gambar yang ini. Ni, nampak ni? This is bone marrow. Some cells in the bone marrow migrate into thymus gland and mature inside the thymus gland. So nama dia T cell. And some of the cell complete its maturation in the bone marrow. So nama dia akan kekal, akan jadi B cell. B for bone marrow. Ha, macam tu. Okay? Okay, so ni lah dia. So from bone marrow, right? So the cell migrate and complete maturation in thymus gland. So then nama dia T cells. Okay. And later on, T cells migrate into the lymph nodes, in the blood and to other organs, for example, for defend the body lah. Okay. As for B cell complete its maturation inside the bone marrow before migrating into the other parts of the body. So that's why nama dia jadi B cell. Okay. Okay. Soalan? Ada soalan?
Tak ada, madam.
Tak ada. Okay. Okay, sikit lagi eh. Stop lah. Okay, next one. Okay, last LO. Explain clonal selection. Clonal. Clonal means making clones. Making clones ataupun making copies. Okay, clonal selection. So, clonal selection is the proliferation, proses pembanyakan. Proliferate means pembanyakan. Okay, proliferations of B cells or T cells into clone of cells that occur in response to specific antigen. Maksudnya bila ada antigen datang kat badan kita, salah satu benda yang akan berlaku ialah clonal selection. B cell and T cell akan multiply, multiply, multiply. That is specific for that particular antigen. Okay. This process is called as clonal selection because an encounter with an antigen select which lymphocyte to divide, okay, and to produce clonal population of thousands of cells that have specific for that particular antigen epitope. Okay, and cells that have antigen receptor specific for the antigen will not respond. Maksudnya apa? Sel lain yang antigen receptor dia orang kata apa, tak sama ataupun tak match to that particular other antigen, it will not respond. Okay, contohnya, contoh eh, tengok ni. You have here, look at the B cells here, B cells A, look at the antigen receptor. Okay, ni B cell, ini pun B cell, ini pun B cell. Nampak? Tapi tiga-tiga B cell ni has different antigen receptor. Okay, and this is your antigen. Right? So your antigen here, the antigen yang datang ni is match with the antigen receptor of this B lymphocyte. So yang lain ni akan undergo clonal selection ke? Tak. Dia tak akan mengalami apa-apa. So yang akan hanya activate to proliferate are those have the antigen receptor match to the antigen. Okay? Alright. So what happened? Activated B cell or T cell will undergo multiple cell division. For each activated cell, the result of proliferation is known as clone. Okay, so tengok eh. This antigen can bind to the specific binding site of this B cell. So this B cell will activate and undergo clonal selections. Meaning that it makes or produce many clones of this B cell. Sebab apa? Sebab B cell ni has receptor that kata apa, match ataupun recognize this antigen. specific for this antigen. Sebab kita nak lawan antigen ni, so kita akan hasilkan tentera-tentera yang kenal antigen ni. Okay, alright. Next, what will happen? Okay, some of the cell, some cells of the clone will become effector cell. Sifat effector cell is short-lived. Tempoh hayat dia pendek. Effector ialah sel yang akan bertindak. Effector cell. Okay. So this effector cell take an immediate action against the antigen or pathogen producing that antigen. Okay, so maksudnya effector cell adalah sel yang akan terus melawan ataupun terus bunuh antigen tersebut. Okay, alright. Example, for B cell, the effector cell will form plasma cell, right? And the remaining cell of the clone will become memory cell. So memory cell is a long leaf that will give rise to effector cells if the same antigen encounter later on. Okay, maksudnya kat sini. This is clone. Okay, remember, some of the clones will become effector cell. Okay, apa sifat effector cells? Effector cells sifat dia short-lived. Okay, short-lived, jangka hayat dia pendek. Right, it will, orang kata apa? Fight the antigen. And for B cell, the effector cell is known as plasma cell. Effector cell of B lymphocyte ataupun B cell is the plasma cell. Okay, and some other clone will become memory cell. Okay, sifat memory cell is long lived. Right, so what is the function of memory cell? It will keep the memory of the receptor and dia boleh quickly differentiate into plasma cell in case the same antigen encounters again in the future. Okay, so apa tugas plasma cell ni? Plasma cell tugas dia secrete antibody. So nampak tak ni antibody ni? Dia hasilkan antibody and look at the receptor of this antibody. The receptor is matched with the antigen. So antibody ni nanti akan buatlah yang proses tadi. Neutralization ke, opsonization ke, agglutination ke, precipitation ke. So dia akan buat benda tu once antibody is produced. Okay, so that is clonal selection. Okay, untuk T cell pun sama. T cell pun boleh undergo proliferation, but the effector cell nama dia lain. Kalau untuk B cell, effector cell is plasma cell. Kalau untuk T cell, effector cell dia ialah cytotoxic T cell. Effector cell ni mesti ialah sel yang akan bertindak balas secara direct. Yang akan terus pergi buat kerja. Ha, itu kita panggil sebagai effector cell. Okay. So I guess we'll stop sampai situ dulu. Nak bagi masa you digest benda ni kan, because it is something new. So ambil masa untuk digest before we proceed with the next one lah nanti.